We have with us this morning Interior Undersecretary Jonathan Malaya. Yusek Malaya, good morning to you, sir.
Yes, good morning, Karen, and good morning to all of our televiewers.
All right. Officially today, Isabong, as of today, was it midnight? Or today, there's no longer Isabong?
It should end today. But yesterday, when the president made his announcement, that to us was already a presidential directive because it was made in a public statement. So yesterday, we already started implementing it, and we are thankful that some of the betting stations have stopped operation already. And in fact, Mr. Atong Ang gave a public statement also that they are complying with the president's order. So we expect that today, all betting stations are closed and all operations of Isabong will stop.
And how many betting stations are we talking about, sir?
Oh, I don't have the data right now, but what we know for certain is that there are around 5 million players nationwide. As to the number of betting stations, I don't have that data right now.
Okay. Now, am I correct to believe they said there were like 400 cockfights a day?
It looks like it, no? Because it's a 24-hour operation. Kaya nga marami sa mga kababayan natin nanlulung dito.
Oo.
So there are a lot, no, of opportunities for people to get addicted to Isabong.
Okay. Now, ang hininto ni Pangulong Duterte ang Isabong. Paano kung ipagpatuloy nila ang pangkaraniwang sabong?
Wala po tayong problema dyan, no, Ms. Karen. No? The traditional sabong, at the very least, actually, that's something that kami sa DILG, mas gusto namin yun. No? We would rather have the traditional sabong because these are held on definite times, no? And it's usually on a Sunday or during a holiday, and you don't get to bet 24 hours a day.
Mm-mm.
So those people who will be displaced by the e-sabong can just go back to the traditional face-to-face sabong, which is allowed, no, under alert level 1. All you need is a authority from the local government unit.
Okay. Now, I know that it was Secretary Anyo who recommended it to President Duterte. What were his findings that led President Duterte agree to his recommendation?
Well, from the very beginning, the president already had doubts about Isabong, particularly about its impact to the public, no, the social cost to the public. So what he did was to direct the DILG through Secretary Anyo to determine the public sentiment about Isabong. And if people actually support it, if majority of the people support it, and if there are any concerns from the public. So that's what we did, no? We conducted a survey last April 19 and to April 20. And just to make sure that we have a good sample size, we made it nationwide. And we have respondents from all local government units in the country. So fortunately, we had 8,463 respondents. And in this survey, 62% of the public is against Isabong, while only 34% supported it but wanted tighter regulation, while only 4% supported it completely without any change. So this was the findings that we forwarded to the president. And the president said it validated his concern from the very beginning. And I think that was the basis for his final decision. Kasi yung presidente natin nag-aagam-agam nung una, he was concerned about the lost revenue from Isabong. But when he saw that the public, no, was very worried about this and that the public was concerned about the social cost, I think that tipped his decision to suspending the operations of Isabong.
Oo. And other than the social cost, there have been reports of actually members of the Philippine National Police already involved in Isabong operations.
Yes, that's correct, Karen. In fact, in the case of the missing Sabongeros, the Philippine National Police has filed cases against 5 identified PNP officers from the Laguna Intelligence Branch of the Laguna Provincial Police Office.
Mm-hmm.
So there is a definite finding that some police officers are actually involved in or already involved in Isabong.
Okay. Now, with President Duterte's order, is there a risk that Isabong can go underground? Are they able to operate this, for example, underground? Or given the need for technology, it's not possible? Because we do know that with Isabong, what makes it lucrative, attractive, and addictive is you actually pay by phone, right? So I'm curious, without that particular aspect, is it possible that this can go underground?
I don't think we'll have a problem regulating it because it will be principally three agencies that will lead the implementation. That's the DILG, our attached agency, the Philippine National Police, and PAGCOR.
Uh-oh.
On the part of the DILG, Secretary Anyo already made a directive to the local government units and to the PNP to work together to stop the operations of Isabong. What are to be closed? The studios where the physical Isabong is recorded for it to be live streamed. Number two, the betting stations that were authorized by the local government units. And the LGU and the PNP know exactly these areas. So it would be easy for both agencies to implement the order of the president. On the part of PAGCOR, they can also stop the operations by revoking the authority or franchise that they issued. So I think with the three agencies working together, it would be easy to implement the president's directive.
Okay, so a clarification. The particular stadium or area wherein the cockfights usually happen, that's where the live streaming is shot, that studio, for example. Once it's shut down, it's not allowed to be used for anything else that's cockfighting related.
Yes, yes, that's correct. And we know where these studios are. They have permits from PAGCOR and from the local government units. So we know exactly what to close.
Mm-mm. Now, Mr. Ang's permit is solely for Isabong, or is he permitted to operate other types of cockfighting? In other words, without the streaming aspect of it?
I'm not entirely familiar, no, Karen, with his operations, but I know that before he entered Isabong, he was into traditional cockfighting. So I would presume that he has existing permits for the traditional cockfighting. And may I emphasize again, that the DILG would rather have the traditional cockfighting rather than the Isabong. So the there's not no legal impediment to traditional physical cockfighting. This can continue to operate subject to regulation by our local government units.
And just for the record, are there rules on what days traditional cockfighting can only happen?
These are regulated by LGUs. So insofar as the existing rules are concerned, traditional cockfightings happens during Sundays, sometimes on a Friday and during holidays. Not like Isabong, which is every day and runs 24 hours a day.
Okay, so just for the record, dapat as of today, wala ka ng laban. You shouldn't be betting on any more fights over the phone.
Tama po yan. That's correct.
Okay. Anything else you'd like to add, sir? What are the penalties? Penalties involved for those who will not follow the orders?
Continuing to operate Isabong at this time would be illegal. So those who continue to defy the suspension of Isabong can face arrest and can be charged in court, no? But I think what I would like to emphasize is the moral cost to Isabong, which we were able to determine through the survey conducted by the DILG. Because when we asked the 62% who were against Isabong, what were the reasons why you would oppose Isabong? Number one, they said the addiction. No, they know of someone or a friend or a family member who has been addicted already to Isabong and would not stop utilizing it on a daily basis. And also the bankruptcy a lot of people have become indebted. And in fact, I have heard of stories of people who killed themselves, you know, who committed suicide because of the indebtedness and bankruptcy caused by Isabong, which then leads to the cost to the family, separation and all of that. And also the addicted individual already neglects his work or even his studies. Isa pa pala yun, Karen.
Even students. I heard even students, they gamble with their allowance.
Yes, that's right. It was a creeping invasion.
Yeah.
Which we just allowed during the pandemic because it was a big industry and a lot of people profited from it and we wanted people to earn money. Ang nangyari, it became already so loose and a lot of people were already utilizing it. Even if formally, it's supposed to be 21 years old and above. No, there was a formal age requirement. But our survey showed that there's a lot of 21 years old who are below the 21-year-old cap who were patronizing Isabong.
Yeah.
So there's something
wrong with the
registration
process. But because you can bet on the phone. That's the problem. The problem, what makes Isabong very different is that you can just bet using your phone.
Yes. And the registration process, I think, had some loopholes wherein some minors or those below 21 were actually able to use it, even if legally they're prohibited from using it. So when we had the survey, we were able to get all of this data from the public, and this is what we forwarded to the president. And this is, I think, what tipped the president to finally deciding to suspend Isabong in our country.
All right. Now let's move on to the elections. Undersecretary Malaya, what are the preparations? Anything different that you're seeing this coming May 9?
In terms of anything different, yesterday, the Commission on Elections already issued the guidelines on the anti-vote buying program or the constitution of the anti-vote buying task force, no? And we have been requesting COMELEC to expedite the issuance of the guidelines so that this will serve as the guidelines to the Philippine National Police in implementing the rules and regulations insofar as anti-vote buying is concerned. So today, we expect to issue a memorandum to the Philippine National Police to create dedicated anti-vote buying teams in each of the cities in the country and in each of the congressional districts so that when there are complaints from people, meron po silang tatawagan. No? May tatawagan yung ating mga kababayan na special team na siyang a-action dun sa mga reklamo on vote buying because in the past, we had so many complaints, but we just forwarded it to COMELEC, and we don't really know if these were acted upon. So the intent of the department is to have anti-vote buying teams on the ground, so these can be mobilized whenever there are reports about vote buying in the community.
And where will these teams be?
These will be designated by the Philippine National Police, so they will be based in the camps where they are assigned. So the COMELEC and the PNP will have to work very closely so that when there are reports received by COMELEC or the PNP, they can then be relayed to the dedicated anti-vote buying team so that they can act on this immediately.
All right. On that note, thank you very much for joining me today, Undersecretary Malaya.
Thank you very much, and mabuhay po kayo.